tonight, we really need to continue in the vein that we've been, okay? Because we're really understanding ourselves in these last few parsha. We're closing out the book of Genesis, right? And where do we fit in these things? Is this just history, or is this prophetic? And if it is prophetic, who's it for? Who's it to? You know, is this something for us, or is this something for somebody else? And if we believe that the word is written, then it's relevant for us now, then we believe it was prophetic. We believe it was written as a prophetic book, and which means there's still something in there that explains our lives. And if it didn't, how could we reach into it for hope? If it didn't, how could we reach to it to and hold on to the promises and hold on to all those things? So it does. And we've talked the past couple of weeks, you know, the last four parshot of Genesis is amazing as we talk about the story of Joseph and we start to see a lot in there. And I love the whole, just everything about it. But a lot of people are really going through an identity crisis, you know. Once we give our lives to the Lord, you know, we're told in the scriptures, okay, so when he brought them out of Egypt, he says, the things that they did in that land, don't do those things. Oh, and by the way, the land that you're going to, yeah, don't do those things either. And so we're kind of, well, what do I do? What am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to act? Don't act the way you did and don't act what you see. Well, I don't know any other way. We need to rely on his word. And so he was teaching us, okay, I want to make this covenant with you and I want you to walk in these blessings, these things that I have for you. And here's how you keep that life. It's a path. And don't go into this ditch, don't go into that ditch, and don't go running back to Egypt. And just set what we're doing. But we're kind of jumping ahead, right? So this what we're finding is this whole identity crisis thing. The reason why a lot of people say that, okay, well, we like reading the New Testament. We don't really like reading the Old Testament because they don't see themselves there. And if you really start to read it and start to open it up, you'll start to understand that you are there. And that's one of the things that Joseph helps to really explain to us, you know, now, in our lives today, all right? So, as we left off last week, Joseph and his brothers, you know, they were reunited. Joseph revealed himself to his brothers. He said, go back and get Dad and everyone and bring him back here, and we'll take care of him. They brought him. They set up camp, so to speak, in the area of Goshen and doing all these things, and it was really good, right? And so he was there for a period of time. That's where we pick up here. Okay, so let's jump into it, and as we do, we're going to reveal a lot of things that we'll see, not just through history, but we'll see the things that are supposed to happen in the last days. And let me ask you a question. How many of you guys think that we could be in the last days? I mean, I think that if Rav Shaul said they were close to the last days back then, how much more so now? You know, if these are really the last days that are coming, what are some of the things that are prophesied in the Torah that's going to happen in the last days? This parsha reveals some of that. And it's, like I said, and even just over these past four, we had a portion of scripture called Miketz at the end, talking about things that are going to be revealed at the end, with here at the beginning. The word is so rich, isn't it? All right, you ready? All right, so we start with Vayechi, and he lived. The Vayechi, the word is Hayah, is the Hebrew word Hayah, and it means to live. You know, how many of you guys are familiar with the word Hay? You know, the Chet and Yod, yeah, Hay. You know, it means life, okay? And so Hayah is where that word comes from, means to live or life. It also can be revived, something that is repaired and restored. Isn't it interesting that even the word for life, we have the idea of being restored, restoration, and being revived? And so we see that in the life of Joseph, and Yaakov, right? And Israel, as he was also called. So we look at this. Yaakov lived, that's this word, Vayechi, and he lived, I say this way, and he was revived. Because we know that when Joseph was gone, he was depressed. But here we see, when he realizes that Joseph is here, his spirit revived within him, and now he had this new found life, this joy and everything, because in his eyes, Joseph was resurrected. You know, he was dead to him. He didn't even know he was alive. He thought he was dead. 17 years later, he's alive. Wow. And so this is what we read in this Parsha. Yaakov lived or was revived in the land of Egypt 17 years. Thus he lived to be 147 years old. Wow. All right, so if we keep reading, 47:29 says this. So the time came when Israel was approaching death, so he called for his son Yosef and said to him, if you truly love me, please put your hand under my thigh and pledge that out of consideration for me, you will not bury me in Egypt. Again, this is the idea of restoration and the land where you belong. He wanted his resting place even for his body to be back in the land, okay? And so he says, so rather, when I sleep with my fathers, you were to carry me out of Egypt and bury me where they are buried. And he replied, I will do as you have said. He said, swear to me. And he swore to him. Then he was comforted. And then Israel bowed down at the head of his bed. Okay? In reading of itself, it's no big deal. But when you understand other scriptures that interpret this a little bit different, say, what are they trying to say? Okay? Well, Hebrews talks of this scripture this way. By faith, Yaakov, when he was dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph and worshipped leaning on the top of his staff. So was it bed or staff? And see, I told you the Bible was full of errors. Well, here's the thing. The word that's used there could read either way. Okay? So it could be mita or it could be mata. Either way. But it's the same word for either thing. All right? We even have a parsha called Matot, and it means tribes. So think about this for a minute. It could be a bed, a resting place, or it could be a stick that represent the tribes. Now, what do you think of when we talk about Israel and Joseph and a stick and the tribes? Again, we see restoration here. And he's talking about his dying and his final resting place and where he's going to be. And in his final resting place, don't leave me in Egypt. Don't leave me outside of the land, but bring me into the promise. So in all the promise, even the gathering of the tribes and gathering the sticks and gathering all these together, it's all seeing what the Father has planned. And that's a lot. And it's just one of the things that if you just read by, no big deal. But if you really look at it, you see the Father is really alluding to some more stuff. I mean, why would the writer of Hebrews translate it as staff, as a stick? Because maybe they understood the something about the tribes being reassembled and being brought back in and being gathered. Matter of fact, you see it so much. It's one of those things to where you really don't pay much attention to it, but once you see it everywhere. Okay, so it's not just in these parsha. You really see it just about throughout the whole thing. Genesis 48:1, a while later someone told Yosef that his father was ill, and so he took with him his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. Verse 5, so now your two sons who were born to you in the land of Egypt before I came to you in Egypt, they are mine. He says something interesting to him. He says, so your two boys that were born to you in Egypt, Ephraim and Manasseh, or Manasseh and Ephraim, they're mine. And you can see Joseph going, yeah, okay, sure, whatever, Dad. But something big was about to happen. He says that they are mine, Ephraim and Manasseh. And again, who does he list first? Ephraim. Who was the older? Manasseh was the older. Okay. They will be as mine as much as Reuben and Shimon are. So the children born to you after them will be yours. In other words, these two, they will be considered sons of Israel, not grandsons of Israel. And then, for the purpose of inheritance, this is where they are. But then the ones after will receive your inheritance. Okay, so this is what they're looking at. For purposes of inheritance, they would be counted with their older brothers. So here's something interesting. And in most of the commentaries and things that you look at, they say, so this is where Jacob adopts Ephraim and Manasseh. The problem with that is how can you adopt what is already yours? Make sense? I mean, they already belonged to him. They were the descendants of his son. Why did he need to adopt them? Well, so the word adopt probably isn't the best word to be used here, okay? And what we have here is this. Even today, we talk about the fathers equal the patriarchs. Okay? You know, so-and-so, son of so-and-so, son of so-and-so. So they're called sons, but what's the difference between someone being a grandson versus someone being a son? There is a difference in one big area, in areas of inheritance. It makes a difference because a parent leaves an inheritance to their sons. They leave the inheritance to their sons. They leave it to their sons. They leave it to their sons. You know, a parent didn't leave an inheritance to his grandson without making sure that his son had what he needed. And then it was his son's place to leave the inheritance to his son. Okay? So they were, let's just say, elevated to a position of sonship, not grandsonship. Okay? So they were grandsons, but for the sake of inheritance, they will no longer be called by grandson, they will be called son. Now, big deal, but it is. Okay? Because this changes a lot. Look at this. Galatians 4:4. When the appointed time arrived, God sent forth his son. He was born from a woman, born into a culture in which the legalistic perversion of the Torah was the norm, so that he might redeem those in subjection to the legalism and thus enable us to be made what? God's sons. Why is it important to be called sons? And it's not just an adoption thing. Why is it important to be called sons? Because that's who gets the inheritance and can still have claim to the heritage. Verse 6. So now because you are what? Sons. God has sent forth into our hearts the Spirit of His Son, the Spirit who cries out, Abba. So through God, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And, this is where it gets really good, if you are a son, then you are an heir. If you're not a son, you're not an heir. So in order for Him to give an inheritance to pass on, and what is it He wanted to pass on? Was it just money? No, He wanted to pass on covenant and blessings. Like we read of Abraham, when he blessed his sons, he blessed, you know, Abraham blessed Isaac, right? And before he blessed Isaac, he sent everyone else away, and Scripture says he gave everything he had to Isaac. It's not just a physical thing. It's covenant. It's promises. Because if he gave everything he had to Isaac, how would he have anything left to give to anyone else? See, so in this case, everything didn't mean all of his monetary possessions. It meant his everything. What did he consider the most important thing in his life? And that was the covenant. And this is what he was passing on. Abraham passed to Isaac, passed to Jacob, passed to his sons. And this is what he was giving in here. Okay? Romans 8, starting at 13. So if you live according to your old nature, you will certainly die. But if by the Spirit you keep putting to death the practices of the body, you will live. All who are led by God's Spirit are God's sons. And here's where a lot of problems come in, because the Spirit and the Word do not contradict each other. Verse 15. You did not receive a spirit of slavery to bring you back again into fear. On the contrary, you received the Spirit that makes us sons, and power we cry out, Abba. So the Spirit Himself bears witness with our own spirits that we are what? Children of God. And if we are children, then we are what? Heirs. Heirs of God, and look at this, joint heirs with the Messiah. And it says, provided we are suffering with Him in order to also be glorified with Him. Are we in covenant with Him or not? And these are the things that we need to keep in mind. Romans 8:18. So I don't think the sufferings we are going through now are worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed to us in the future. And creation waits eagerly for what? Sons of God to be revealed. So who are these sons of God that creation is waiting eagerly for the sons of God to be revealed? Who are these sons of God that creation is waiting to be revealed? I mean, guys, here's some things. Once these sons of God start being revealed, there's a whole lot in the prophetic timeline that's going to get kicked in. And it goes beyond just saying, well, it's you. I agree, but there's more to it than that. Romans 8:22. For we know that until now, the whole creation has been groaning as with pains of childbirth. And not only it, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we continue waiting eagerly to be made sons. That is to have our whole bodies redeemed and set free. Romans 9:4. So who are Israelites? Who? To whom pertains the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the Torah and the service and the promises. All of these things are not negative. All these things are positive. Okay? These are benefits to being Israel. Okay? Why is that important? Because without Israel, you kind of cease to exist. Because God made a covenant with Israel. Ephesians 1:3. Praise be to Adonai, Father of our Lord Yeshua the Messiah, who in the Messiah has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heaven. In the Messiah, he chose us in love before the creation of the universe to be holy and without defect in his presence. He determined in advance that through Yeshua the Messiah, we would be his what? Sons, according and keeping with his pleasure and purpose. Now, guys, this is where we can go back and go to Galatians chapter 3, where it talks about what Yeshua did, and he did it for us, yes, but he did it with the reason that the blessing that God gave to Abraham could go to the Gentiles. And go back down towards the end of 3, and it says, so if you are a believer in the Messiah, you are the seed of Abraham and heirs according to the promise. So if you're the seed of Abraham and heirs according to the promise, then Yeshua did what he did so that the blessing that God gave to Abraham could go to the nations. You see where you fit in that? You see the covenant you have a part of? This adoption, if you want to call it that, was necessary in order to give the inheritance to the ones that it belonged to. I mean, think about this for a minute. We've been taught, okay, so the blessing of the firstborn goes to the firstborn, right? But show me where that actually happened. I mean, there aren't too many instances we can look at that could say the person who was actually firstborn got the firstborn blessing, right? I mean, look at it. Did Isaac or Ishmael get it? Isaac. What about Jacob or Esau? Which one got it? Jacob. So Reuben should be the next one in line to get the blessing because he was the firstborn. But who got it? Ephraim, who was the secondborn son of the 11th son. So what I'm saying here is this is a spiritual principle that the Father had established, but he also understand as well that it goes to the ones who have the heart to receive it. And it goes to the ones that will protect it and walk in it and keep it. Okay? Romans 8:29. Because those whom he knew in advance, he determined in advance would be conformed to the pattern of his son so that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. Like we read in Colossians. It says, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. He is the head of the body, the assembly, who was the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, and then in all things he might have preeminence. He is the first of everything, right? And it's all we exist because of him, okay? Exodus 13, we see this as well. The Lord spoke to Moshe, saying, sanctify to me all the firstborn. Whatever opens the womb among the children of Israel, both of man and animal, is mine. Again, establishing the firstborn. I mean, even the animals, they belong to the Lord. What does this mean, they belong to him? Guys, the firstborn were supposed to be the ones who were to serve the Lord. They were to be the ones who would serve in the tabernacle, serve in the temple, the ones who would be the priests for the household, the ones who would help to give out the blessing and to work in all these. And even the animals, of the animals that were dedicated, were used for the service of the Lord. Okay? But that got all messed up at the golden calf. Because the firstborn didn't do what they were supposed to do. So the ones who did stand up were the Levites. And so the Levites were taken as a substitution for the firstborn. It didn't change the promises for the firstborn. It just said, if you guys aren't going to walk in it, they will. See? Exodus 19:5-6, which coincides with 1 Peter 2, by the way. So now, therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be my own possession from among all people, for all the earth is mine. And you shall be to me a kingdom of Kohanim and a holy nation. And these are the words you are to speak to the children of Israel. So we belong to him, and we are to be a people that are set apart for him. A peculiar people, right? Now, peculiar doesn't mean odd or strange, by the way. It means a people that is protected and treasured and held back, dear to his heart. Genesis 48:8. So now we go to this. So Israel noticed Joseph's sons, and he said, "So who are these with you?" Now, the thing is, did he really not know who was with him? Or was he trying to make a point of something? I think he was trying to make a point of something, okay? And I think we should be asking the same question. So who are these? Who is Ephraim and Manasseh? So if Joseph's sons were to be elevated, why? And I think we see something deeper here. A couple things. Joseph needed to realize what was happening here. By his sons being elevated, check this out. His sons, those that descended from him, became his brothers. And if they are his brothers, then they are joint heirs with him. Let that sink in for a minute. Can you imagine, even in your life, your son becoming your brother? But that means that he has complete and total right to everything that's yours is his. Well, it was before anyway, yes, but it's not a second-hand thing. It's a first-hand experience. Everything that was Israel's belongs to Ephraim and Manasseh, just as much as it belongs to Joseph. And again, why is that important? Because it helps establish the precedent of what's to follow. So Israel says to Joseph, "I didn't think I would see your face. And behold, God has let me see your seed also." Guys, that's prophetic. Because God, "I didn't think I would see your face, but now that I've seen your face," who the world knew as Zaphnath-Paneah, the Savior of the world, or the one who reveals hidden things, or the one who gives the bread that gives life kind of things. "I didn't think I would see you, but now that I've seen you and you are received as this, and then I see your descendants. And then understand that I see your descendants that will be brought as a part of alongside you to be a part of Israel along with his brothers, along with all the rest of the tribes, to be a rightful heir for his part." Genesis 48:13. So Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand toward Israel's left, and Manasseh in his left toward Israel's right. Why? Because who was the older? Manasseh was the older. And Israel stretched out his right hand, and he laid it upon Ephraim's head, who was the younger, and his left hand upon Manasseh's head, guiding his hands wittingly, for Manasseh was the firstborn. So when he blessed them, he crossed his hands so that the right hand went on Ephraim. Why would it matter? Because the right hand was considered prominence for blessing. Okay? He can lay and bless on both, but the right hand was the one for prominence of blessing. To stand on the right hand of someone was a place of honor. Okay? And so this was a blessing that would be going to him. So, and he blessed Joseph. Again, he blessed who? Joseph. So he laid his hand on Ephraim and Manasseh and blessed Joseph. Why would he lay his hands on them and bless Joseph? Because they are Joseph. All right? This is where they came from. This is where they ascended. This is what tribe they are from. So he blessed them, and he says, right here, and he blessed them, may God before whom my fathers Abraham and Isaac walked, the God which fed me all my life long into this day, the angel which redeemed me from all evil, bless the lads, and let my name be named on them. Stop for a second. What did he just say? Let my name be named on them. In other words, when they speak of Ephraim and Manasseh, they will be called by his name. What was his name? Israel. So when you speak Israel, it is to include Joseph's sons. So let my name be named on them in the name of my fathers Abraham and Isaac, and let them grow, look at this, grow into a what? Multitude in the midst of the earth. And let them grow into a multitude in the midst of the earth. If this is the idea behind this is like schools of fish, that are just like all over the place, you know, just like all over, growing in multitudes. 17. So when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand on the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. And he held up his father's hand to remove it. And Joseph said to his father, Dad, you're doing it wrong. And Israel said, I know what I'm doing. Right? His father says, I know, son, I know. He will also become a people and he will also be great. Who's he speaking of? Manasseh. But then he says, however, his younger brother will be greater than he and his seed will become, what's this say? A multitude of nations. That's important to notice, guys, because you're going to see that phrase a lot, and it's very important how that plays out through the rest of Scripture. So from Yaakov, we see would come a people and a community of people. Interesting how we see it this way, because when we back in Genesis 35, we saw this. So God said to him, your name is Jacob. No longer shall your name be Jacob, but Israel shall be your name. So he called his name Israel, and then he says something else to him. So he reaffirmed, your name is Israel. And then he says, I am God Almighty, be fruitful and multiply. Okay, that's again the commission it was at the beginning, right? Be fruitful and multiply. And then he says, a nation and what? A company of nations shall come from you, and kings shall come from your own body. So what is happening here is Jacob, is seeing this scripture being fulfilled through Ephraim. So when he's praying for Ephraim, he's prophesying, he sees this scripture right here being fulfilled in him. All right? Now the interesting thing is, if you look at the phrase, a nation and a company of nations, it reads this way, goy uchal goyim. So goy, nation, and kachal, goyim. The word kachal is the word for congregation or assembly. Now think about this for a second. A nation and the assembly of nations. What nation? Israel. And the assembly, the kachal, of the nations. Who is the assembly of the nations? Those that have been scattered into those nations. And he saw this being fulfilled in Ephraim. Verse 20. So he blessed them that day, saying, in who? You. Again, we talked about this with Avraham. It's not just about because of you, but literally in you, right? Israel will bless, saying, God make you as Ephraim and Manasseh. And he set Ephraim before Manasseh. Did you ever wonder why on Shabbat we pray that? May God make you as a symbol of blessing like Ephraim and Manasseh? It's one of those things, what we see in this scripture right here, it's literally because of this verse is why we pray that. Why Ephraim and Manasseh? Because they received the blessing. Even while their father was alive, they received their inheritance. And then even in that, in the midst of a pagan nation, they still were able to walk in the blessings and the covenant of their fathers. It says a lot. So, who are Ephraim and Manasseh? When Yaakov sees them, he said, Miele, who is Ephraim and Manasseh? Who are these? Well, who are these? Okay, let's take a look at it. These are those who were born into Mitzrayim, born into the nation that represented the world, born into the midst of troubles, right? While the Savior, Zaphnath-Paneah, was estranged from his brothers. They are fruitful, Ephraim, but have forgotten, Manasseh. They are now, if you want to say, adopted or elevated back to their rightful place. So they are no longer strangers to Israel, but they are now fellow citizens and sons. Does that sound like something else? I hope you see it. Genesis 48:19, he says, again, his seed will become what? A multitude of nations. And we see this, his seed will become Melo HaGoyim. His seed will become Melo HaGoyim. The word Melo is means fullness or filling or a multitude, all right? From the word male. And even if you look in the Greek, we even see this as well. These are the related Greek words. I want you to look at this one, pleroma, because it means something that fills or filled to fill up, fulfilling. So what's the idea that we're looking at? that they will go into and fill all the nations, right? So Malo Goy. What's the word for Goy? It means nations. It means nations. This is also where we get the word ethnos. What's ethnos? That's where we get the word ethnicity. So the word Goy is synonymous with the word ethnicity. What do we mean by that? Nationalities, nations. And so what we see is that Israel, they were scattered into all the nations and they become assimilated into all the nations, but the Father is waiting for the right time for these sons to be revealed that he will call them back. And all those joined with him. Romans 11:23. And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. For if you were cut off out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and were grafted contrary to nature into the good olive tree, how much more shall these, which are the natural branches, be grafted back into their own olive tree? For I would not, brethren, that you would be ignorant of this mystery, that you would be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until what? The fullness of the Gentiles come in. The thing is, how do we translate what this means? How do we translate the fullness of the Gentiles coming in? We say, well, just until the Gentiles will come to know that who he is and enter into covenant. And I agree with you, but guys, this phrase goes all the way back to Genesis. It goes so much deeper than just reading through here. Hosea. What we find is that when people turn their back on God, when they were cast into or sowed, if you will, into all the nations, they turned their back on God, is why they were exiled, okay? And so Scripture talks about those that were his people that he will call not a people that shall again be his people. And guys, I'm telling you, this references this. This references us. This references Ephraim. This references you. So God said, call his name Lo Ami. Lo Ami means not a people, so not my people. So you are not my people and I will not be your God. Yet, verse 10 says what? The number of the children of who? Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured or numbered. And it shall come to pass that in the place where it was said, you are not my people, there it shall be said to them, you are, what's that next word? Sons of the living God. So who's this talking about? Who are these sons that he's talking about? Hosea 2:23. And I will, what's this word? Sow. The word sow means to cast into. So I will cast into or cast someone into all the parts of the earth. Who are these ones that were cast into all the parts of the earth that were not a people? The ones who turned their back on him, broke covenant, and were cast into all the earth. They were exiled. So I will show her unto me in the earth, and I will have mercy upon her that had not obtained mercy. And I will say to them which were not my people, you are my people, and they shall say, you are my God. Who? Those that were sowed into all the earth. 1 Peter 2:10. So once you were not a people. Does that mean like you weren't human? No, it means you were not in covenant. You were not his people. You didn't have the place of covenant there. So once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Beloved, I urge you as what? Sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh which wage war against your soul. Sojourners and exiles that we're not a people, but are now called a people. And like I said, this is one of these things where once you see it, you kind of see it in a lot of places. Deuteronomy 32. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God, and they have provoked me to anger with their vanities, and I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people, and provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. So those that were not a people will help to provoke other people to jealousy. Why? Romans 10:19 says, but I say, did not Israel know? First Moses says, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. Because kind of like this, when the people in the area around Judea and all these places, when they saw that the Spirit was poured out on the people, it's not the pouring out of the Spirit that they had the problem with. The problem was that they saw the Spirit being poured out on the Gentiles, and that didn't make sense to them. See, so these are the things, it goes just along the lines of what we just read. Ephesians 2, if you go to verses 11 through 13, and actually the whole chapter, okay, but we read this. Wherefore, remember that you being in time past, what? Gentiles. You were Gentiles. You were without the Messiah. You were aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, without God in the world, but now in the Messiah, you who sometimes were, where? Far off, are now brought near by the blood of Messiah. And this is not just a far off as a matter of spiritually, but it's a far off as physically too. You who were far off, not just, you know, you can be in Jerusalem and still be far off. This is not just a matter of spiritual, this is spiritual and physical. You who were scattered all over the place, you who were exiled, you who were farthest to the ends of the earth, are being brought back and obtaining your place. This goes back to Jeroboam and Rehoboam. If you want to read through that, you can go back and read through more. We won't go real deep into that, but just so that you get the references, okay? So you know what happened. 1 Kings 11 says, Solomon slept with his fathers and was buried, and his son reigned in his stead, Rehoboam, okay? So what happened here is that we find in 1 Kings 12, so they sent and they called, and Jeroboam, who was an Ephraimite, and all the congregation of Israel came and they spoke to Rehoboam, which was Solomon's son, who ruled the kingdom. And they said, your father made our yoke grievous. Now therefore, make the grievous service of your father and his heavy yoke which was put on us lighter, and we will serve you. What they're saying is, king, if you could, ease up a little bit and we'll serve you gladly. And how did he respond? The king answered the people roughly, and he forsook the counsel of his elders, and he took counsel from the young men. There's a problem, right? And he spake to them at the council of the young men, saying, my father made your yoke heavy, I will add to your yoke. My father chastised you with whips, I'll chastise you with scorpions. Wherefore the king hearkened not to the people, for the cause was from the Lord, that he might perform his saying that the Lord spoke by Ahijah the Shilonite to Jeroboam the son of Nebat. What he's saying is, oh, you thought my dad was tough? You ain't saying nothing. Wait till you see what I do to you. Now get back to work. Right? Kind of like Pharaoh was, right? Well, the reason why you talk about this, you want to go and serve God is because you get too much time on your hands. Let's just make them so busy that they don't have any time to pray. Where else have we heard stuff like that? You know, that was the assignment from Pharaoh to the people. It's the same assignment in the earth today. You need to make priorities for what the Father is setting as priority. Okay, so what happens? So Israel rebelled against the house of David, and it came to pass when Israel heard Jeroboam was come again, they sent and called him to the congregation, and they made him king over Israel. Now Jeroboam was from what tribe again? Ephraim. So Ephraim ruled the northern kingdom. Okay. So there was none that followed in the house of David but the tribe of Judah. So again, notice Israel, house of David, and this will come to be known as Israel and Judah. The house of Israel would be called by the northern kingdom, and Judah will be called the southern kingdom. Okay? And so the land was split. And this is the way it looked, the split right through here. And an interesting note is, here's Jerusalem. Okay? So the northern kingdom did not have access to Jerusalem. Jeroboam didn't like that. Because what happens when the people go to Jerusalem? And the festivals and the feasts and all these things happen there, and the people go to Jerusalem and there's joy and everything. Maybe they don't want to come back. So he instituted additional feast days, set up altars in other places, and said, guys, why go all the way to Jerusalem? Just go over there. And in a sense, profaned what God had said to do. So he set up the altars in the area of Dan for people to come to worship instead of going to Jerusalem. He instituted days for festivals that Yahweh did not declare. And he allowed sibling rivalry. You hear me? He allowed sibling rivalry, rivalry with his brother Judah, to prevent himself and his people from gathering together for worship. Even on Shabbat, and even at the designated times, even in the designated place. And it's because of this they were exiled and cast into all the earth. Is it pretty serious? 1 Kings 14:7. So go tell Jeroboam, thus says the Lord God of Israel, for as much as I exalted you from the people and made you prince over my people and rent the kingdom away from the house of David and gave it to you, yet you have not been as my servant David, who kept my commandments, who followed me with all his heart. He said, even though I gave you the kingdom, you didn't follow me. You didn't do the things you knew you were supposed to do, and you led the people astray. But you have done evil above all that were before you, for you have gone and made other gods and molten images and provoked me to anger and has cast me behind your back. 1 Kings 14:15. For the Lord shall smite Israel as a reed is shaken in the water, and he shall root up Israel out of this good land which he gave to their fathers, and shall what? Scatter them beyond the river. He's just scattering all over. Because they have made their groves, provoking the Lord to anger. And he shall give Israel up because of the sins of Jeroboam, who did sin and made Israel to sin. So because of a sibling rivalry and because of idolatry, they were all dispersed. One thing led to another, led to another, led to another. But the scripture says God will do what to you? He will call you back. And so those that were scattered will be returned. We see in Isaiah 5:26, he will give a signal to the faraway nations. He will whistle for them to come from the ends of the earth, and here they come fast. Here's something interesting. He will give a signal to the faraway nations. The scripture says, Nes Lagoyim. Nes is a banner or a sign or a miracle to Lagoyim, the nations, to the Goyim. So what happens here is when he signals for the Goyim, there will be something that signals the Goyim. I wonder what that something was. Oh, I know. Could it be something like Messiah said, that the Son of Man will be lifted up, just like the serpents, the bronze serpent, were lifted up in the wilderness? And he will be that banner. He will be that miracle. He will be that rallying point for the nations. Zechariah 10:6, I will strengthen the house of Judah and save the house of Joseph. Listen to this. If they're back as one, why is he identifying them as two? It hasn't happened yet. I will strengthen the house of Judah, save the house of Joseph. I will bring them back in my compassion for them. They will be as if I hadn't driven them out, for I am Adonai their God, and I will answer them. Ephraim's men, who are we talking about? Ephraim. Ephraim's men will be like warriors. Their hearts will be cheered as if from wine. Their children will see it and rejoice. Their hearts will be glad in Adonai. I will whistle for them. Again, there's that loud, he's calling out. I will whistle for them and gather them because I have what? Redeemed them, and they will be as numerous as they were before. Look at verse 9. And I will sow them among the people where? And in distant lands they will remember me, and they will rear their children and what? Return. You know, it's one of these things to where, you know, a lot of people like to talk about biblical prophecy and all these things that are happening in the last days, and I'll get to that in a minute. But we miss this. This is literally the, if you want to draw a thread from prophecies through Scripture, this is the big one. It even involves the Messiah. Ezekiel 36. Say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, I do not this for your sake, house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake, which you have profaned among the heathen where you went. He's speaking to Israel, and he's saying, you went among the nations. But he says, I will take you back. I will regather you. I will bring you in. I will give you a new heart. I will give you my spirit. I will do all of this for you. But the idea is that those that have been gone will return. 16. Son of man, take one stick and write on it for Judah and for the children of Israel, his companions. Then take another stick and write on it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, for all the house of Israel's companions, and join them together. We talked about this last Shabbat, where the joining together literally just means just bring them close to one another. Okay? Bring them near to each other. And then he says this. So when the children of Israel shall speak to you, in other words, so you're going to talk to people, you're going to say this, and the children of Israel are going to say, we don't get it. What the heck do you mean? What do you mean by these things? I don't understand. Again, interesting how we talk about the sticks and the tribes, and the word for stick and tribe is synonymous. So when the people of Israel speak and they say, will you show us what you mean by this? Say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will take the stick of Joseph, which is in the hand of Ephraim, and the tribes of Israel, his fellows, and will put them with him, even with the stick of Judah, and make them one stick. And they shall be one in my hand. Our job is to bring the sticks close to each other. Then he said he will take that and be one in his hand. We can't force the sticks to be one in our hand. We just need to try to get them close to each other. And then he's going to make them one. And the sticks where you write shall be in your hand before their eyes, and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will take the children of Israel from among the heathen where they have gone, and gather them on every side, and bring them into their own land. And I will make them one nation in the land on the mountains of Israel. One king will be king to them all. There shall be no more two nations, neither shall they be divided to two kingdoms any more at all. Neither shall they defile themselves with. I mean, you see it. This is the Father's desire that we come back in to be gathered as a single-hearted people. Okay? Verse 25, and they shall dwell in the land that I have given to Jacob my servant, where their fathers have dwelt. And they shall dwell therein, they and their children and their children's children forever. And then my tabernacle will also be with them. And the heathen will know I sanctify Israel when the sanctuary is with them forever. I mean, all of this is just flowing. And we see the restoration that the Father is desiring to give. But all of this restoration comes from, first thing, the people coming back. And the question is, how can you come back to something if you never left it? Back to Genesis 49. So Jacob called to his sons, and he said, gather yourselves together, that I may tell you what will befall you when? In the last days. Prophetic? Yeah, very much so. He's not just talking about his last days. You know, he's not saying, okay, I'm getting ready to die, and I want to tell you a few things before I die. No, he says, come and look at this. First thing, he says what? Gather yourselves together. And then I will tell you what will happen in the last days. The word in the last days, ba'acharit hayamim. Literally, in the last days. So, gather yourselves together. Then we see, again, he's speaking to whom? All his sons, all the tribes. And we see the thing of all of them being gathered together that I will tell you what is to happen in the last days. So again, we see a gathering together of all the tribes in the last days. We even talk about like the year of Jubilee, and you hear a lot of people talk about these things, and it's really neat. But the interesting thing is the year of Jubilee cannot be declared until all the tribes are in the land. So when does that happen? When the Messiah comes back and gathers them. 49:2. So in other words, in the end days, in the last days, you will, what? Gather yourselves together and listen to this. And hear who? Sons of Jacob, the tribes, and hearken to Israel, your father. So if Israel is our father, that means we must be sons and part of those tribes. 50. So then after burying his father, Joseph returned to Egypt, he and his brothers and all who had gone with him to bury his father. And think about this. Realizing that their father was dead, Joseph's brother said, now he's going to take revenge on us. Not exactly, but that's kind of what they meant, isn't it? They were scared. And the thing is, they're questioning whether Joseph really forgave them. And here's part of the problem, guys, because we still kind of do things like this in our life today, okay? What I'm saying is this. We have a hard time, say for an example, I'm going to pick on, who can I pick on? I'm going to pick on Wes. There's no one's volunteering. I'll pick on Wes. Let's just say that Wes and I have an issue. He says he forgives me, but I don't believe him. He said it, but you know what the problem really is? The problem is I have a hard time forgiving. So I think he's the same way I am. And if I will have a hard time, I mean, if something happened and he did that to me, buddy, you know what I'd be doing. And here's the problem. When we go through circumstances, situations, and we project the way we are on others, it doesn't go well. And so Joseph's brothers say, if someone had done to us what we did to him, although I could say I forgive them, I would probably in the back of my mind be waiting for a moment to see if I could retaliate. And they're kind of thinking maybe Joseph's the same way. But he's not. So what happens next? Verse 16. So they sent message to Joseph and said, your father gave this order before he died. Say to Joseph, I beg you now, please forgive your brother's crime of wickedness, doing harm. So now we beg of you, forgive the crime of the servants of the God of your father. And Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Why would he? Because he said, guys, I already told you, I forgave you. I mean you no harm. It's done. Matter of fact, I forgot about it. You brought it back up. It's over. And it doesn't mean that he treated them any different either. You know? Even when he was talking to his brothers and different things and all this whole process. I mean, he said, am I in place of God? No, you know, it's not his place to do that. It's not his place to be there. So he forgave them. Why? So that they could dwell together in this place that the Father has given them for safety, for protection, for life. Because if they did not dwell together like this, they wouldn't have survived the famine. But yet these last years of Jacob, his life was revived. Joseph was gone for 17 years. And then those 17 years were given back to Jacob, because he lived there in Egypt for 17 years with Joseph. So that which was taken was restored, and then there was a blessing there just for all of his people. Again, Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking the what? Assembling of ourselves in fractions? No, it says. Together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. Guys, how many of you see the day approaching? The thing is, Scripture says, this implies, in the last days, there will be people who will forsake assembling together. That's not important. You don't need to do it. What's the big deal? The big deal is God said to do it. And so we assemble and we gather together to be a community to one another, to help each other out, to get to know each other a little better, because, you know, we're all family, but we're extended family, right? So we learn to grow together, and we need to learn to be a light to the people out there. That means that you're going to be different. Okay? Don't forsake assembling together, because the more you assemble together, the better you get to know one another. The problem is, the more you assemble together, the more chances you have to forgive each other. Let's put it that way. Think about when they all came out of Egypt. I mean, this is, you remember the count, right? 603,550 men aged 20 to 50, not counting everybody else. Do you think somebody in the midst of that got offended with somebody? You get five people together, someone gets offended about something. Okay? The question is, what do you do with it? Do you stop assembling and stop gathering because now you can't do that? Or do you understand that, well, these are some issues that maybe I need to work on something, maybe they need to work on something, but maybe together we can figure out what, how we can continue to walk together. Amen. Romans 12:18 says, if possible, so far as it depends on who? You live peaceably with all. Guys, there are some people who don't want peace, and they're not going to get it. But you can live at peace even though those around you are living in turmoil. 2 Corinthians 13:11. Finally, brethren, farewell. Be perfect. What does that mean by be perfect? The scripture says be perfect. It doesn't mean never make a mistake. It means be upright. Walk righteously. Be upright. Be perfect. Be of good comfort. Be of what? One mind. And this doesn't mean that we think exactly the same thing. It means be of one mind. Be of one goal. Be of one purpose. Live in what? Peace. And the God of love and peace shall be with you. Amen? Okay, so a couple things to note. This parsha starts with a declaration of life and ends with a prophecy regarding the last days. What's the emphasis? Forgive. Yeshua said it this way, for if you forgive not those who trespass against you, your trespasses will not be forgiven. Forgiveness is important, isn't it? We need to learn to walk together. We need to learn to dwell that way. And we need to learn to gather, especially in this day, because many people are scattering all over the place. And what happens when you turn the light on? The roaches scatter. We need to gather, right? And let's do that. Well, if this teaching has blessed you, I want you to check out our other resources. You can check out our website at www.ruachonline.com. And there's links there to other resources that are available to you, other teachings, other books, other offerings. You can go to YouTube, Facebook, all of these things from our website, and check us out. Because if they enjoyed this teaching, there's going to be much more that hopefully will bless you as well. Thank you. Hi, this is Dr. David Jones from Ruach Ministries International, and I've got some exciting news for you. We have a new series coming out, 6-part series of the Gospel According to Abraham. Abraham? What does he got to do with the gospel? Well, you're going to have to find out, aren't you? The thing is, Galatians 3 says that the gospel was proclaimed to Abraham. So what does that mean for a believer today? What does that mean to a person who is not Jewish? What does that mean to a person who is Jewish? What does that mean for all of us today? Well, check it out. It's a good series, and it'll be coming your way soon. For more information, you can check out our website at www.ruachonline.com. Hi, this is Dr. David Jones here. I just want to say we do have some other resources available to you, one of which is a book entitled Famine, Walking and Blessing in the Time of Famine. It's based out of Amos 8, 11 and 12, talking about there's a famine of hearing the word of the Lord. So what is that famine? Does it mean the word of the Lord is not being proclaimed, or does it mean there's a famine of actually listening to it? Food for thought, isn't it? Well, if you want to know more, check it out. Go to www.ruachonline.com, and there's a link on our homepage. Just click and it'll take you for more information on the book entitled Famine, Walking and Blessing in a Time of Famine. Well, how important are the feasts of the Lord? I think we can say that if the Lord set out a banquet, set out a table, and invited you to come be a partaker, would we answer? Would we hear? Would we go? Or would we blow him off because we have something more important to do? Well, that's what this book is. The King invites you to his table. Are we going to answer the call? The Feast of the Lord, appointed times where the Lord has said he wants to meet with us face to face. Will we heed? Will we answer? Will we go? Check it out, www.ruachonline.com. On the homepage, there is a link to take you for more information. The King invites you to his table.